Latoya Ruby Frazier from Braddock, Pennsylvania, whose work in photography photographs that tell you what has transpired over time in this her hometown. Latoya Ruby Frazier's here. Tim Rollins is here. Tim Rollins and Kids of Survival. Tim was here in residence in Springfield last March. He worked at the charter school, the Renaissance School. Mike Gillane is one of the teachers at the school. This was a fabulous collaboration, and so the artwork that was produced at the school is on view at our museum under the umbrella of Tim's work with students and schools. Mary Evans from London is here, and we'll show images of her remarkable work, which has also a two-part counterpart. It's going to be seen in Accra, Ghana, the place where Du Bois died 50 years ago. So there's an interesting connection to Africa. And Jim Campbell, scholar on Du Bois, has come over from Stanford University. We're honored to have the artist and Jim in conversation about the exhibition. So I really hope you'll come. The museum is open Tuesday through Sunday. Please check our website. And again, it's wonderful to collaborate with the museums. And I want to thank Christine McGarren again for opening up the auditorium to us to talk to you about the work. Scholarship is done behind the work. Thank you.
As Loretta mentioned, the exhibition, which informally opened, had its formal opening on Friday night, is an exhibition we hope you'll get up to see at UMass and the Fine Arts Center. It's quite extraordinary, and it is an attempt on the part of 10 extraordinarily diverse artists to think through the meaning of one of the really consequential lives in African and American history as a whole, the life of W.E.B. Du Bois, who, as I'm sure most of you know, was born in Berkshire County in 1868, died in exile 50 years ago in Kwame Nkrumah's Ghana. And I think probably the most profitable thing would be to just introduce a little bit of the both the work that these artists have done previously, but perhaps we can show you some images of what's awaiting you up in Amherst. So can I ask you guys, and I don't know which one of you wants to start, say a little bit about yourself and your work and the project that you did.
I'm Tim Rollins. In 1980, I was recruited by a very dynamic Puerto Rican American principal named George Gallego to come and start an art program for his very distressed public junior high school, Intermediate School 52, on Kelly Street in the South Bronx. To make a long story short, I was going to be there for 2 weeks to establish the program for the special ed kids, and I ended up staying in official full-time public school teaching situation for 8 years, and now I've been living and working in the community for the last 30 years. And to be honest, there's been ups and downs, but I still find it all joy. And so we had a wonderful opportunity when Loretta asked us, me and the group KOS, Kids of Survival, to work on a work that would be inspired by the great life and legacy and spirit, and I would say love, of W.E.B. Du Bois. And I thought it would be terrific to work with a local community, because that's what gets us all excited, and that's what brings an element of surprise and suspense, sometimes panic, but at this point now, celebration. And so I said, well, you know, what could we do? And they say, we know this wonderful school in Springfield called the Renaissance School, and it's someone we would like you to meet. And so we came up and we met, and I always embarrass him, but Michael Gillane is one of the greatest art educators in the nation. And you are blessed, and I've been around. And I've seen some of the worst art educators in the nation, you know, that had to suffer them. So yeah, he's the best. And so we worked with him, and it was a master class of what, fifth, sixth, and seventh graders, right?
Six, seven, and eight.
All right. And it was about, how many of us? 18 of us by the time we got done. And we rocked it. It was absolutely beautiful. And so the work that we created individual works, and then the works that we created are now in the exhibit at the UMass Museum, It's inspired by the great text published in 1920 by Du Bois called Dark Water. And we're also very proud to make two announcements. Number one, that it is now in the permanent collection of the University of Massachusetts Art Museum. So the young people, some of them had worked on this here. So that will look very good on your resume and your college applications, because I teach grad school at School of Visual Arts. I'm a professor, and some of my folk never get even near a museum. So you are blessed. And the second announcement I wanted to make is that we had such an amazing time. And actually, Michael, the workshop came at a point where you know what it's like being a teacher, and especially if you're a long distance runner like I am, and sometimes you go through seasons of doubt, like why am I doing this and how can you keep doing this? And it came at a really beautiful time when myself and Angel Abreu, a long-term member of the group, came to work with your class, and that was a complete affirmation of how we must go on. And it was so joyous and exciting for us. So we have talked to your wonderful principal, and we are going to be coming to your school, hopefully yearly, to conduct master classes on our own. Is that all right? And so, yeah, this is me yelling at young people, this is, we're actually baptizing pages from the first edition of Dark Water in a pool of very specially made watercolor. We have it fabricated for us. It's called Furnace Black. And then there's this beautiful Lasco golden acrylic. So what you have in the pages when they are placed on the wall is this, it's this beautiful river-like image that is glistening in gold. And we took all our, essentially we took all our visual cues from the text. So do you remember that time that we read the Credo? Du Bois, and then it just hit me. I said, okay. And I said, all right, everybody, you have a half hour to write your own credo. Give me one half hour of writing, telling the world what you believe. No pressure. And it came out with the most beautiful, beautiful, beautiful statements. And these are going to be, I talked the other night, these are going to be published in the big catalog. So now you know you have something in the museum, but now you have your first for real publication. And we're going to give you a little more time to work on them. Is that all right? Yeah, because this is, you're making history. I told you. I told you it's going to happen. Do we have any more images of some things we've done? And then we'll move along. We always paint on the classics of world literature and music, considered too difficult for my kids to understand or engage with. And I hate that. One of my greatest favorite lines of Du Bois is, he says, I sit beside Shakespeare and he winces not. And it moved me at a very young age, and I never in my wildest dreams thought that I would be placed in a position where I could take that sentiment and put it into daily action for the transformation of young lives, institutions, and communities. And I'm a witness that our project helped do that over the years. And this is a work we've done, a series done on Duke Ellington's The River. This is a work based on the autobiography of Malcolm X. This is in the permanent collection of the Smithsonian Museum of American Art, which I was shocked when they chose this particular work. And that's yet another one. Next, please, the series. This is on incidents of the life of a slave girl by Harriet Jacobs, and they are cascading beautiful white satin ribbons that go over the text and fall onto the floor, like some sort of transcendent spiritual river again. Next, please. That's on Martin Luther King's Suffering and Faith. See, what happened is that, and Michael will testify, is that we get very engaged in the text, because if the kids do not internalize the writing and the meaning of it, then the work will have no authority. So what I love is that this is a wonderful, proactive curriculum, right? But instead of just getting an A, or instead of getting, you know, a certificate, which is really wonderful and nice, I'm not putting that down, but what is wonderful is that the trophies of our learning are evident in the material of what we make. And then what happens is this: when I'm not around, when you're not around, this thing is on the wall, it continues teaching. They're teaching machines, and I'm glad about it. Yeah, more Kane works. Next, please. That's another one. Next, please. So these are the ones we're best known for. And we'll stop with this, because this is on a book by Franz Kafka called America. And basically the story is of a young kid that leaves Europe, coming to America for the American dream. He is lied to, he is exploited, he's duped, and he is scorned, and he's about to go back home when he's adopted by this utopian commune called the Nature Theater of Oklahoma. And the Nature Theater of Oklahoma has two rules. Number one, everyone is welcome. And number two, everyone is an artist. And so the kid, Carl Roseman, says, I'm down with this. I like this idea. And even if it's a fraud, this is the most beautiful fraud I've ever heard of, and I'm with it. And so he goes to a stadium, and it's this amazing scene where everyone is playing what they want to on these crazy, these golden horns. And I just posited the question that I said, if you could portray your voice, your dignity, your anger, your rage, your fear, your all in all in the form of a golden horn, what would it look like? And guess who was a huge, enormous influence on these paintings? You got it? Dr. Seuss. And yeah, and some of these horns are literally taken, they're traced from Horton Hears a Who, right? And Green Eggs and Ham. All right, and Bartholomew the Ooblick, and of course the Lorax and the Butter Battle Book, because he was a very political author. And what is fascinating is I was friends with him, right? So I just sort of creeped in to the language of what we were doing, and that's all right. So that's what I do. And thanks for having me.
Hi everyone. My name is Mary Evans. I'm from London. London, England. London, England, yeah. I know there's a London in Canada somewhere, but yeah, London, England. I was born in Nigeria, but I mostly grew up in England from the age of five. I've been working with a technique where I use paper cutouts, kind of cut out silhouettes, and work directly onto the kind of the walls of a space with them. I came to this project slightly late. I was invited to join this project round about March, April this year, mainly because I've been commissioned to make a piece of work for the Du Bois Centre in Accra, Ghana. It's a place that I knew a little bit. I visited the centre in 2005. I just happened to be on a visit to Ghana, and I went to see it. So when I visited the centre in Accra, it's where Du Bois is buried, and I was walking around, and somewhere, I don't know whether it was on his tomb or somewhere, I noticed that his birthday is February the 23rd, which is also my birthday. So there was this immediate, just a little frisson, a little kind of coincidence that I thought, oh, that's interesting. And so the piece that is on in UMass is a version of this, and it's called Held, February the 23rd. And it's a piece of work to do with me visiting in Ghana. You have what is left of the kind of slave forts and castles where enslaved Africans were held before being transported to the Americas and the Caribbean. So this piece of work is kind of my interpretation of what those spaces might have looked like, kind of peopled with African figures waiting to be transported. What happens quite often in my practice is that I will make things more than once. So this piece was made last September, and I've made it again for this exhibition. But it looks different. It's across two walls. It's not exactly the same. It's always for me, it's a really good challenge to be asked to show the same piece of work again, and then it takes on the qualities of the new space or the project, the history. My work is nearly always based on some kind of historical event or piece of information or document in some way. I'm kind of interested in looking at how people move around the world. I moved from West Africa to Europe as a five-year-old, and it's what fascinates me in general about, it doesn't matter what your diaspora is or wherever it might be from, there's something that interests me there's a kind of sadness in taking on an epic journey like that. And the hope is that one day you will return to that place. But then there's a kind of resignation, I think, also. You can live for 50 years with the resignation that you'll never return to that place. And it's something that kind of reminds me of my mum. My mum went to Nigeria she moved there in her early 20s, and she's now in her late 60s. So there's this kind of feeling of, will I ever go back? Generally speaking, I cut things out. I cut out paper and I stick it on the wall. But I also cut out cookie dough. So this is gingerbread. These are little gingerbread figures that I have displayed in the schematic of the slave ship. It's an image that I first got to know when I was about 14, and I was actually living back in Nigeria for 2 years, and I saw. I think I'm sure that some of you are familiar with the image of how. People were packed into the slave ship. So I decided to make a version of that. This is currently on show at the Blaffer Gallery in Houston. It opened in an exhibition there called Feast 3 weeks ago. It's on till December the 7th. So the idea for me with this piece of work is that the ingredients that make up the figures are the kind of ingredients that enslaved Africans were made to work. So it's sugar, it's spices, it's allspice, it's ginger. And it's very, very simple. Simple idea, but hopefully not simplistic in sentiment, really. This is in China in 2008. And it's one of my favorite installations. It's a maze. And I was invited to show them. Whenever I'm invited to exhibit anywhere. I want to do something that has something to do with the place or the history of the place. I don't really, even though my work is about dislocation, I don't want the piece of work that I end up showing to be dislocated from its environment. So I remember growing up as a child in Northwest London, and nearly everyone, all my friends' mums had a dinner service called the Willow Pattern. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this kind of Chinese, people are nodding. Chinese blue and white porcelain. I've seen it everywhere. I've seen it here, I've seen it at the Smithsonian, it's all over the place. I had it, my mum, I think, is down to her last teacup. You know, she had six children, they're like, you know, they're all kind of broken. But they were just, it was just everyday stuff. So I had friends from Jamaica, India, and Ireland, and us from West Africa, all on my street, and we all had the same set. And what I always kind of remember about that is that all our mums were immigrants, but they all had this set that I feel as though they thought, this is English, this is quintessential, this is English, we want an English dinner set. But it's not, it's Chinese. You know, but that's what's interesting about how people move around the world and they take a certain cultural capital with them. It's Chinese because Britain was in the Opium Wars with China in the 18th century, and that's how it came to Europe, and that's how we came to know it. But it's just been absorbed into the culture. So these are the sorts of things that I'm interested in. Maybe we could scroll forward. So when I made this in China in 2008, the visitors came to the opening, and Most of the visitors didn't speak English, but they just did this. And that is that's a universal sign of, yeah, that's great, I like that. They understood it, they knew what it was, they had a map for it in their own culture, so they understood why I had used it and where it had come from. So that's the kind of interaction that I like to have with my audience, you know, that no matter what direction your life might have taken or where your ancestors might be from. We've all picked up and dropped and lost something along the way. And also we can kind of pick and choose and take from other people in other cultures. And that's one of the things that kind of inspired me about Du Bois. I mean, he campaigned for his whole life to be, he was proud to be African-American, but he campaigned to be seen as an American and to have the civil rights that was due all Americans and in the end all humankind, you know. So he moved around the world. He was an internationalist and he was a Pan-Africanist, and that's kind of what I'm interested in being involved in this project. Thank you.
I'm Latoya Ruby Frazier. I am an artist and a photographer from Braddock, Pennsylvania. Braddock is a historic steel mill town located 9 miles outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and it runs along the Monongahela River. This image that you see here on the right is, it's called John Frazier, Latoya Ruby Frazier, and Andrew Carnegie. These images were scanned out of a history book that was published in 2008 called Images of America, Allegheny County, Braddock, Pennsylvania. The two historical significant things about Braddock is that it's the first town where Andrew Carnegie's steel mill, the Edgar Thompson plant, is located since 1872. And it's also where his first library, the Braddock Carnegie Library, exists, and it was just marked as a National Historic Landmark this past spring. And then I'm sitting in the center there with an image that my grandmother took of me. She always liked to dress me up as a porcelain doll. So I bought that book from the Carnegie Library, and I went home really excited to look at its history. Braddock had many people immigrate to it from all over the world. So it has a large melting pot population of Scottish people, people from Ireland, people from Germany, Croatia, Italy, as well as African Americans that migrated from the South. So as I looked through the book, once I got to the end of the book, I realized that all African Americans were omitted from this book. And you know, it was released in 2008. And my grandfather worked there in Carnegie's mill, one of the few African-American men that was able to maintain his health to retire with a full pension. Historically, most African-American men were discriminated against. They were not given equal pay, and they worked some of the worst labor. And so what ended up happening is generation after generation, we inherited a debt because we never received the same equal pay. As well as, you know, witnessing all the men and the women suffer and die from the exposure to all the toxicity in the mill and the hard labor. So making this image, appropriating those two images from out of the textbook and then inserting myself in the center is really me in a visual way trying to address how does one create a new narrative, a counter-narrative and a complementary narrative where you're a part of the history that is your heritage. I mean, I embrace my heritage of, you know, coming from a steel town that was created and developed by Andrew Carnegie, and there are a lot of things that, you know, my family does culturally that come from people from Germany and Scotland, and so I feel very much a part of that. And so my work is a corrective to that history and that omission, and also addressing a lot of not only social and economic concerns, but environmental concerns. Anyone who was born and raised from Braddock and is still there today is suffering from terminal illnesses. I've been battling lupus most of my life, and I know that you get lupus from being exposed to too many toxins and living in areas where there is so much traffic from trucks, which I was in an area that was redlined, where certain immigrants or African Americans who were not deemed, you know, as part of the middle class, we had to remain there in this strip known as the bottom, and it was right next to the mill. My grandmother recently passed away in 2009 from pancreatic cancer, and my mother has been battling cancer as well as a neurological disorder. And so, you know, as a youth that was very aware that I was born into poverty and a harsh reality, I, you know, just quietly would observe these things. I didn't have the money or the power to save my family. The only thing I knew to do was to pick up a camera. And I learned about how to use the camera as a weapon through reading Gordon Parks' book, his autobiography, A Choice of Weapons. He describes, you know, his encounter with Washington, D.C. and working for Roy Stryker. And at the end of the book, he says he used the camera as a weapon to combat everything he didn't like about America, which is poverty, racism, and discrimination. So what I started to do was make portraits with my family collaboratively to give them agency and the freedom to document themselves as they wanted to address some of these problems with healthcare and social and economic injustice. So you could go into some of those images. What was interesting for me about being invited to this project was that, you know, the last 10 years, I've made these personal intimate portraits with my mother and my grandmother. Often I appear in my images because I think it's very important that if you're an artist that is privileged to a certain type of knowledge and to a certain kind of skill, it's your responsibility to empower the people that you're working with. So here's an example. Do people know the image Migrant Mother, the iconic image from the 30s? How many people? Okay, so what's the woman's name that's in the photograph? And I was 17 years old when I started thinking about that question. Like, why don't I know the woman's name and I only know the photographer's name? And why do I see this image all over the world now? What happened to that woman and her children? I wanted a name and a face to her reality. And this is what caused me to start to go home and give the camera to my mother and allow her to photograph not only herself, but also me. Her name was Florence Owens Thompson, and she never received royalties from that image, and it's become an iconic American image, and she died still living below the poverty line, and her children never received anything from it. So my work is gelatin, silver print, black and white to speak back to that history, but also to update it about what's going on in Rust Belt towns today. The Du Bois speech that I read that inspired me to create a new series that is actually not here on my website, it's only at the museum on view right now. The title of the series is, well, the speech is, Du Bois came back to his high school in 1930, and he addressed the crowd and said, I'm gonna talk about something from a philosophical point of view that you're not gonna expect. And what Du Bois began to talk about was the condition of the Housatonic River. You know, he lived next to that river. And what he witnessed was that people, you know, threw waste in it and didn't, and basically the town, the way it was laid out, turned its back on this river. And he described the Housatonic River as the center of the picture. And I was thinking, you know, after 10 years of making portraits with my mother and grandmother in the house, it was time to come outside. And once I went through the way he described the beauty of this river and the spirituality of the river and how it's connected to our bodies and our lives, I decided to go up in a helicopter and fly over the Monongahela River, which is the river I grew up next to. So I took his speech and turned it into a visual representation in these large photographs that are 30 by 40 color transparency prints that are on light boxes. And the reason it takes on that format is that I see these transparencies as an x-ray of the land, so almost in this archaeological, medical kind of way, surveying the land for the viewers here, connecting what he described about the Housatonic and Great Barrington to Braddock, Pennsylvania. And so the title of the series is A Desfoliation of Water from the Housatonic to the Monongahela River, 1930 to 2013. And I think that it's very important for people to be aware that Du Bois had environmental concerns. And this is something that is seldomly discussed or talked about. People don't think of Du Bois as an environmentalist. And by reading that, I was able to take this whole new approach to my work and expand it into a whole new direction, which is gonna be very compelling to see those aerial color views of the river's degradation next to these portraits of the conditions that my family and I have been living in. Yeah, so I mean, I just think that it was just very important for me to highlight that about Du Bois.
I think you see why this exhibition is worth taking a run up to Amherst and having a look at. Several things that have just been said really stuck with me, and so I'm going to try to ask a question or make an observation about what each of you have said. That image of the gingerbread men, that's actually, some of you have probably seen that image. It's an iconic image. It was a woodcut of a slave ship called the Brooks. It was done, I think, in the 1780s. And what's powerful about that image, what most people don't know about it, it was done by abolitionists to show the conditions in which Africans were being transported, particularly in the huge ships that were sailing out of Liverpool. But the dimensions actually reflect that the British government had just enacted a reform to make the slave trade more humane and had sharply reduced the total number of people who could be transported, establishing a formula of the number of cubic meters, or they would have said feet, per person. And the representation you see of the Brooks was designed to show people that this is what it looks like now, after the reform. So I think that that's an extraordinarily powerful thing. And I also love something that you've just done that I try to do with my students that people never, ever seem to cotton on to. Actually, that's a perfect metaphor for the point I'm about to make. The products that enslaved people created were products that became sources of comfort and solace, cheap calories, and mild addiction for people living in Europe. Cocoa, chocolate, is actually invented out of the transatlantic slave trade. Cocoa, coffee, sugar, tobacco, which I think would have been in some ways one of the most important sources of comfort and addiction, although mercifully less prevalent today. And so if you actually ask what people in the West, the United States and Europe, have sort of done for breakfast for the last couple hundred years, what most of us had probably some of those products for breakfast this morning. So that so much of the kind of comfort and pleasure and solace of Western life is built on this hidden foundation of pain of other people. And I think that's just an extraordinarily kind of compelling image. And so I'd love to hear sort of more about what led you to this particular.
So this is the first time I made a version of the gingerbread work. And it was in 1999. It was the first Liverpool Biennale. Liverpool being one of the main port cities of the transatlantic slave trade in Britain. And I was asked to take part in some of the fringe events that were going on. And I thought, okay, Liverpool. I knew Liverpool because I studied there for a year, near there for a year. And so I thought, well, I can't do anything in Liverpool without talking about having something to do with the slave trade. That's the only reason Liverpool is there, really. So what I did was, actually, years earlier, a friend of mine, as for a present, had given me the tiniest cookie cutters I had ever seen in my life, just as a present. Just because, at the time, I was starting to work with these figures, and it was just a nice gift, Christmas gift. So I made these cookies, biscuits, we call them, really. So I made these biscuits, and they were male and female. And I put them in a bag, and then you might be able to just see that the schematic that we were just talking about, the graphic of the slave ship on the board there. I printed that out as the label for each bag. And on the back of each label, I printed out gingerbread, ingredients, sugar, butter, ginger, allspice, flour, blood, sweat, tears, and then just wrapped up each packet. And what I wanted them to look like, and I hope you agree that they look like, these kind of cute little souvenir-type packets of biscuits that you would get in a gift shop in England anyway, in like a ye olde worldy gift shop kind of place that you sell, you know, if you go and visit somewhere, a stately home or something. I wanted them to look like that. And then they were on display at the Tate Liverpool Cafe. So I asked them, they were very nice. I said, oh, can you just have, I had hundreds and hundreds of bags of gingerbread. And I said, can you just display them with your other baked goods? So they had muffins, shortbread, and then they had my biscuits there as well. And I said, can you sell each bag for £1? When they're all sold, just give the money to whatever charity of your choice. And then I went back to London, and I would ring up every now and then, how's it going? And they said, well, they're selling like hotcakes, you know? And I said, well, I want to know what do people do when they buy it? So what people do, they would buy a packet, they get a coffee, oh, what like a shortbread, oh no, let's try this gingerbread. They buy a packet of gingerbread, and they'd walk away with their coffee and their gingerbread, and they'd walk to find a table, and there would always be a point where they would stop, because they had just realized what they just bought, and are they going to sit and eat them with their cup of coffee? And I just thought, wow, that's amazing. So it's just kind of turned it into this performance that I wasn't there to witness, but it just became this, oh my God, maybe I should have got the shortbread. You know, so people would, you know, I don't know whether people would eat them, but it started me on this. So I've been making them since 1999, and every now and then I make them and I package them up and I just send them through the post, through the mail to friends. And then people just don't eat them. So my friends have got these rotting, moldy, kind of stale packets of gingerbread on their mantelpieces because they're keeping it because it's an artwork. And so the one that with the, if you forward to, So this version that is on now in Houston with the on the tabletop, the idea for me was when they asked me to do it, they said, well, are you inviting people to eat these? And I said, no, I don't want, they're not for consumption. The idea was these people have already been consumed. You know, their lives are consumed in the slave trade. I don't want these biscuits. People always want to eat them, you know, because, you know, they smell nice, they're real. I could make them with chili or whatever. I could make them so that you can't eat them, but I don't. I make them so that you could eat them if you really, really wanted to. And they smell delicious. And it's this enticing kind of, oh, I really want it, but, oh, my God, look at what it is. And there's this pull, and that was a pull that was happening for 400 years, you know, during the slave trade. And the work is kind of referencing that, really. Plus, as a five-year-old moving to England from Nigeria, one of the first things I learned to make was gingerbread men. You know, we just made them at school. This is something that kids do. So it's that kind of play on that. And I suppose it's an ongoing project. I will make it again some other time, or maybe in another version or something.
Thank you. Let me turn to LaToya next. I was really delighted when I saw what you were doing in your exhibition. Everyone knows what Du Bois written, what Du Bois wrote about the Housatonic. It's amongst the most quoted passages in his writing, and he in fact appears in three different places in his writing where he describes his birth in Great Barrington. I was born beside a golden river in the valley of two hills. And it's this wonderful idyllic image. And it was only later in something else he wrote that he points out that the reason the Housatonic was golden was because there were all these textile mills and dye factories, and they were dumping golden dye in the thing. And other days, he could have been born by a green river or a blue river or a red river. And so the speech that you found, I think, is a stunning example of, again, the complexity of the man and the way in which it's so easy to misappropriate the kind of romantic and miss some of the things he's trying to tell us. In any event, in the comments you made, I thought what was most powerful was you talked about your desire to create a counter-narrative. And that, in some ways, I think, in the largest sense, is what Du Bois' entire career was about. I mean, he was first and foremost a historian. And he was trying to get a nation that imagined itself as white to understand something about its history, about its politics, about its economy, and about its culture. And at the end of Souls of Black Folk, he famously says, clearly addressing white people, your country, how came it yours? 400 years we have been here, mingling our gifts with you. So I guess I'd love to hear more if you have any thoughts about this idea of a counter-narrative and the way in which, clearly, I mean, you tell a beautiful story about finding a book about your hometown and realizing how partial that was. But if you can expand a little bit on that idea or that theme in your work, if that's helpful.
Yeah. Well, some of the major themes in my work are the body and the landscape, familial and communal history, private and public space, and above all, American history and social activism. One other site of Du Bois' work that really informed the way that I produced the work here for UMass was also reading the Philadelphia Negro. And while looking at the charts and the statistics and the graphs in the book, it dawned on me that clearly Du Bois was not interested. I felt like he had a love-hate relationship with the photographic image of people, because the statistics were so harsh, and the disparity between the way African Americans were living in Philadelphia versus their counterparts. I would imagine that he chose not to put those images of them in that book because of that simple fact of the good versus the bad image. So that kind of informed me going up in the helicopter and only shooting these very large panoramic landscapes and feeling like I could progress and move away from the portraits I was making of myself and my mother and my grandmother. But I feel like his groundwork and the foundation of his writings has given someone like me an ability to actually put a face and a vision to these statistics that he has written about. I mean, these things have still remained the same over decades. There hasn't been that much significant change to some of these towns in Pennsylvania when it comes to the conditions that African Americans are living in. And that's really everywhere, like Detroit, in the South. I mean, these are all problems everywhere that people just keep pretending aren't there. So the counter narrative is the only space where I can start to speak back to these types of unclaimed injuries that we have faced. It's not that I'm proud or I want to make negative images or difficult images to digest. It's that these realities exist, but our society doesn't allow us to confront them. And if you don't confront them, you can't heal from that. And it just means that history just becomes this cyclical beast that continues to consume and ruin lives and silence and erase people. So I think that in the grand American narrative of Andrew Carnegie and Braddock, Pennsylvania, it is so fundamental and necessary for the story of three generations of African American women, like my grandmother, my mother, and me, to finally be brought into the history of that town to deal with that history. Our injuries have to be acknowledged in some way, and this is the way I know how best to do that. I've been writing text with my photographs, so if I came back and did a lecture here, what would actually happen is I would stand in front of all of you and perform this narrative with prose and information about the town, the history of photography and art, and how we go about making the images while the images are kind of rhythmically turning behind me. So it's like a narrative that weaves in and out of American history, photo history, personal history. The other thing I'll highlight is, was there an image of a man standing in the street holding a sign saying race-based, class-based? So the man you see here is Mr. Jim Kidd. In 2010, because some of you may have heard of Braddock, there's Levi Strauss, an advertising agency, Whiting and Kennedy, branded Braddock as the new frontier for urban pioneers to come forth and redevelop it. And the irony to this is that Braddock's population is mostly African American at this point, but above all, elder citizens. And this campaign goes out globally all around the world. They have videos, commercials, saying it's the new frontier. And at the same time, our historical hospital, our community hospital, was being torn down. The slogan for Levi's was that everybody's work is equally important. Go forth. We are all workers. So here I am witnessing elder citizens protesting in the snow, the rain, day and night for a year, trying to stop our hospital from being taken from us. My grandmother died in that hospital in 2009. 6 months later, we found out that they chose to close it. And this is something happening all around the country. They're closing our community hospitals in some of the most impoverished towns that have the worst environmental degradation because of industrial pollution. And no one is paying attention to it because it's elderly citizens or African Americans or Latinos, and it's just, we're invisible to society, you know, at large. And so what I began to do, because I was seeing these billboards stacked like four stories high in New York City, I would drive back home to Braddock and I would show up. And Jim is a part of a group called Save Our Community Hospitals. There's about a dozen elder citizens that I happen to know, and they've known me since, you know, I was a kid. I started making portraits of them showing up early in the morning, whichever angle they wanted to shoot in front of the hospital, with whatever message and sign they decided to hold. And we would make these portraits. I then took these portraits and turned them into photolithographs, where I then appropriated all of Levi's ads with all these hipsters saying it's the new frontier. And I took text that was from people like Jim and silk screened it under the images, over the images from Levi's, as well as putting these images up next to them, juxtaposing them. And it was this other counter narrative that basically showed viewers how to deconstruct ad campaigns and advertisements that continue to erase marginalized people or elderly people. I was raised by my grandmother, so I'm very sensitive to the way that our society kind of casts, like elderly people are castaways. And I actually don't agree with that, because that's where the most significant history is. So, you know, these are two different ways that I've continued to produce counter narratives. And I've made sure that these works go into institutions, into their permanent collections, so they can be used for art and education to continue to teach people, but also to preserve these cultural and historical moments and injustices against working class people.
Well, that's actually a yes, please. That's actually a segue into the question I sort of wanted to direct to Tim. The other, kind of in some ways even more astonishing, act of casting away that our society is involved in as we speak is the casting away of children. And when you see the proportion of our children in this country who are growing up in poverty, and the, in particular, the proportion of children of color who are growing up in poverty, it is staggering. And so I guess, Tim, I'd like to sort of return to that theme with you. You've talked a little bit about it, and I'd hope we might be able to hear from some of the kids who are here. But part of what you've done, your work is not only interesting intrinsically, but it's also interesting processually, and the way in which you've come to integrate children and work with children in the work that you do. And I guess I'd like you to expand a little bit on that, and maybe particularly in the context of Darkwater, since, as you know, one of the most powerful chapters of Darkwater is an essay called The Immortal Child, which really makes the case that human civilization exists in some fashion for the sake of the child, for children, and their infinite possibility. And, we're living in a society that those words that were so prophetic when he wrote them are in some ways even more prophetic today. So does that give you any food for thought?
Yes, big time. Because it's one thing to read a book, and it's another thing to use a book. And I think growing up in rural New England, I'm from Maine, but that's something in our DNA, even though my parents weren't particularly well-educated, and they were working class. My mother never graduated from high school. We were in a very rural area. That's why it's nice to go through the hills here, because it reminds me of home. And yes, I was raised by my great-grandmother, which was a blessing. And so, but the more I started going through my education, it became kind of obvious that really the thought of people like William James and Josiah Rote, and then of course Du Bois and Dewey, and up all the way to Martin Luther King, had great, and Emerson and Thoreau, a great American pragmatist tradition is just in my blood. And so it's one thing I always say to be a hearer or a reader of the word, and then you must become, at a certain point, a doer of the word. And my heartbreak when I started teaching, I was all of, what, 25 years old, and I thought I was like the white city Poitier in To Serve With Love, you know, those teacher movies, and Michelle Pfeiffer in Dangerous Minds, and Finding Forrester and all that stuff, Conrack, all that stuff. And but I was supposed to be there for 2 weeks, and I could not believe the beauty of the kids, their intelligence. They happened to be kids that hated school, but they loved art. And I knew I was impelled against all common sense, against all what my friends say, are you crazy, are you kidding? Because the Bronx at that time was boom, boom, bang, bang, like unbelievable. But I was angry. And of course my hero, Martin Luther King Jr., in a great essay called The Strength to Love, talks about, he says that anger comes from the Norse root to grieve. And that's why I connect so much to these artists here, because it's not raging, it's not despair. But it's grieving and using a positive and militant form of anger. I was angry and I still am angry. If they would sit there, my kids, and they're obviously gifted, and then you would go to the administration and you had teams of people getting paid tens of thousands of dollars to tell us what our kids could not do. Learning disabled, emotionally handicapped, academically at risk, dyslexic, truant, educatable, mentally retarded, my favorite, which I always talk about, ADD, attention deficit disorder, right, Mom? Kids that can sit in front of a, you know, a Game Boy, right, and playing Grand Theft Auto for 8 hours straight without taking a bathroom break, and they got ADD? No, they had TDD. Teacher deficit disorder. If you can't say amen, say ouch. And so I was on a mission, and I said, you know what, after a few years, I said, we gotta get out of this place if that's the last thing we ever do. And what we did is we had this posse, they called themselves KOS, Kids of Survival, and we marched to our own space on Longwood Avenue, just a few blocks away, still there. And the issue is they had all these labels, and I said, well, if they can do that, but then how come Carlos can memorize like a Snoop Doggy Dogg's CD side A and B without one four, it'd be huh, get the huhs right, and duh. So what we did is I started making books on tape, my own, because everyone claimed they had no money for anything. I literally had to bring my own toilet paper, Michael. I had to bring the pencils. The only thing you could maybe liberate from somebody would be an overhead projector. We used leftover library book covers for the cellophane and to draw the corn images, for example, and then using the overhead projector that I liberated from a burnt out science teacher. He wasn't burnt out because he was never on fire in the first place. And so we just had this secret little club in that was supposed to be in my classroom, room 318. And so what we had to do is we were on a mission. We were so angry with it, we were being collectively dissed, that it was so important to make beautiful things. People actually had the nerve when KOS and I started exhibiting. These things are too beautiful. Caught that, right?
Caught it, right?
No, we're supposed to be abject. Supposed to be having fifth-rate graffiti, you know, the Latinos are supposed to be doing palm trees and maracas and stuff like that, right? It's supposed to be, you know, mad ghetto, you know? And I come back with that wonderful author that Du Bois loves so much, Dostoevsky, who says that when you get right down to it, only beauty can change things. And that reminds me of growing up, at, you know, age 12 or 13, and watching these kids down south during the civil rights movement, just marching by singing these wonderful freedom songs, right? The kids. And so I was able to share that sort of history that has never been shared with kids in a contemporary way, to make that connect. What is so important is when we get together, and you remember the first day, and I said we were gonna have a seance, And he said, "Ooh, this guy's creepy. This is scary. This is New England." I said, "Yeah, just let's hold hands. Okay, let's bring him on down." And we summoned down the ghost of W.E.B. Du Bois. And he came on down, didn't he? Grinning, laughing, like, "Oh, this is who I wrote for. I did not write this, and I'm not putting anyone down, but for comparative, you know, political scientists and philosophers at UMass or Harvard."